So as Canadians approach that retirement age, what's that number to retire?
That's a great question. There's not really one number for any one particular person. It really depends on their situation, what kind of lifestyle they want to live in retirement. And so people need to do some research into that and then determine what the number is.
So I guess the way that you would measure it then is by taking a look at your lifestyle, and what are some of the other components you need to look at?
Well, when you think about your government income supplements that you'll have received, so CPP, and whether you choose to defer that or take that will have an impact in terms of how much you'll have available to you. But generally, we recommend that people start with their lifestyle, what kind of expenses they're going to need to incur as part of their lifestyle, how much they may want to save for health care and other related costs, and use that as a starting point to determine how much you'll need.
Do you think, when you take a look at some of the trends, like retirement trends, I mean, there's been a generational shift in the way people have been saving, spending. Has there been a change?
Definitely, we can see that. When it comes to one generation to the next from a retirement standpoint, we know that the boomers have changed a lot of things. They have different expectations for their lifestyle. They want to be more active in retirement, and that's leading to different types of needs from an expense standpoint. And they're also taking on more debt in support of that lifestyle and to help them through those years.
So what are some of the things, I know that you touched on, you know, you can defer or start your CPP. What are some of these elements that you should be looking at as part of that plan?
Well, I think when people think about retirement plan and they come up with how much they need to have saved, a couple of things that they can look at is whether they should downsize to help finance the retirement. In fact, what we found in our savings, about 52% of people thought they would downsize to help support their retirement. Others are choosing to work longer. In fact, that's a growing trend that we see with people continuing to work longer into retirement, and I think which is natural given the longer expected lifetimes that we have.
Inheritance, is that something you think people count on?
People do count on it. I mean, it's not necessarily something that we'd necessarily recommend for everybody to count on,
yeah,
because you never know what's going to happen. But people definitely do count on it. In some cases, it's certainly a meaningful portion of the retirement savings.
When you take a look at retirement savings now and today's generation, I mean, everything just seems so, you're not owning a property. You're no longer owning a vehicle. What does retirement look like in the future?
I think in the future, it's a really good question. I think, you know, where we don't have defined benefit plans, where we don't necessarily have home ownership and those other things, people are going to have to take, I think, their finances more in control and making sure they have the right plan in place, making sure that they're saving as they need to, because they may not have the same resources available to them that, you know, the previous generations had, such as using your home equity to help finance your retirement.
So some of these numbers, I guess, that were bandied around in this RBC report were, I guess, around the 900,000 mark. Is that generally where people should be at?
You know, what's interesting about the number is that there is a gap, you know, 900,000, and then, you know, people are a couple hundred thousand dollars short of where they need to be. But what we've actually found with people that are in retirement is actually they end up needing less than they actually have had to save. And so what they thought they would need to have, they typically make do with less.
So they're over-planning. That's a good thing.
Yes, yeah. It's a good thing in the context that I think people adapt, you know, and we tend to adapt very well to whatever our means are available to us. We find different ways to stretch our money, we find different ways to save on taxes and other things. So I think that's the good news, that people may have concerns that they haven't saved enough yet today, and a plan will definitely help with that. But at the other end, people also learn to adapt.
So you're saying that there's a little bit of discrepancy in terms of what people have saved and, you know, where they should be at. And what do you sort of account or attribute that to?
I think there's a lot of things. We have a lot of sort of rules of thumb that have existed for a number of years. People have $1 million in their head and in terms of what they think they need to have saved, and that's come from, you know, a lot of different sources. There's people that use the 70% of your pre-retirement income as an example, but on average we find that people need to use less than that. And so people have developed these sort of rules of thumb, I would say, over time. But not necessarily tied to their own specific lifestyle. And that's where we think that planning and doing it based on your own specific lifestyle and needs are what will really help at a more concrete number for people.
And so what are the elements that you would need, I guess, as part of this plan or this retirement portfolio? I know that you've listed, I guess, cash, or you got to take a look at all sources of income. What are these components?
So the things that we definitely recommend, start with your expenses, as we talked about. The other pieces, as you start to think about the sources of income, there is the government pensions like CPP and OAS, and whether you're entitled to a supplement for your OAS. for guaranteed income. There are other elements too around leveraging your RRSPs, your TFSAs, so those registered savings plans. We have your home equity, as we talked about. And then we have our non-registered savings and checkings that are another source of income that people can leverage. And finally, there's benefits that people can apply for depending on their situation, whether they're supporting dependents and taking care of people and other sort of tax benefits they can leverage to help them through the retirement years.
What do you think this boomer generation can teach the next generation?
Well, I think they've done a really good job in terms of actually accumulating a large volume of savings. So they've have had some of those habits around save. They are increasing, they have increased their spending, but they have certainly instilled those habits about save and start saving as early as they can. And that's something we definitely think is important for the next generation to also join, is to start that saving as early as they can. I think the boomers have taken a good view around what I want to do in my retirement. We're really changing the landscape in terms of the kinds of things that they like to do. And I think taking that sort of proactive stance is very helpful, and it's something that the next generation can start to think about too, which is, what do I want to do in my retirement? So what does that mean I need to save for retirement?
At what point should they start thinking about that?
It's never too early, but I also say it's never too late. If you haven't started saving, by all means, you should come in, get some advice, and see how you can make some room in your cash flow to start to do that. But obviously, I think the earlier you can start saving for your retirement, the better off you'll be.